Possible. Bearing in mind that whatever refreshment we may partake of will be non-tax deductible, Mr. Lovejoy.
Of course.
Come on.
Your nice little place is so limpid.
And there's more from Lovejoy at the same time next week. Radio Times in full colour with brighter, clearer pages.
This week, only in the Radio Times, an Alexi sale exclusive.
And another exclusive, real cookery can be child's play. Radio Times sets the scene for my new series, Eats for Treats.
And read all about the proms, the BBC Symphony Orchestra, and my co-star on the front cover.
Radio Times, the most colourful way to put yourself in the picture. Now on one, putting us in the picture on your points of view, here's Tony Robinson.
Hi, summer's here, the football's over, so what can we watch on the telly?
The BBC have shown so many repeats that I'm sending you a photocopy of my TV licence. I'd like to know if I can use it for a further year, as I really do object to paying for programmes twice.
Oh, come on, Mrs. Rackham, think of all those sexy BBC stars giving you value for money night after night.
What was Angela Rippon wearing tonight on Come Dancing? It looked like her bra was outside her dress.
Right, Francis Barker.
Michael Burt's tie always needs that extra little shove up so that it meets his shirt at the top button.
Well spotted, Stephen Doyle in Liverpool.
Can somebody please tell him, because I'm fed up trying to do it for him through the telly.
And what's your complaint, Bernard McCarthy?
Please tell Des Lynham that his new hairdo and makeup are a dismal failure. It makes him look like a woman.
And Geoffrey Williams asks...
Why is it that when Jonathan Dimbleby interviews politicians, his chair is always higher than theirs?
I think it's because he's so short, Geoffrey. How about you, Neil Burns? Who's your favourite star?
Please get rid of that snide, loathsome woman who they've inflicted on you to read the results on your Wimbledon programme.
Good Lord, it's Des Lynham again.
The way she gloated over the 10 British girls that lost today quite made my stomach turn in disgust.
Only 10, Neil? Well, there must be someone you like.
What a delight to see Bruce Forsyth back on our screens in his great new game show Takeover Bid.
It's been the highlight of my year, Nicholas Chaplin.
Not only is it an entertaining production, but it teaches contestants initiative in business matters and reflects well in our shining enterprise culture. It annoys me when people complain about game shows. Cheap and tacky they are not. It's wonderful to see people's mental dexterity being rewarded with large amounts of money and fabulous prizes. How can these shows be described as fodder for simplistic, brainless viewers when people such as myself, a student of Warwick University, no less, enjoy them so much?
Where would we be without intellectuals, eh? Take Trudy Coburn from Bishop Stortford, for example. She's researched all the remarks made by the Wimbledon commentators and lists them for us under the following headings. 1. The intelligent.
That ball would have been a winner if it had gone over the net.
2. The perverse.
Lendl seems stunned by Edberg's penetrating trajectories.
3. The personal.
When the server has new balls, it gives him a great advantage.
4. The profound.
Of course, the essential difference between singles and doubles play is that there are two players on each side of the net in doubles.
I really feel I've learned something this evening, don't you? Gary Wood makes a telling point about a question of sex, the heart of the matter programme introduced by Joan Bakewell.
A member of the clergy proclaimed that transsexuals should not resort to surgery, but turn to God if they're to come to terms with their problems. A bit rich coming from a man who looked as if he was wearing a big black syrup.
Cockney rhyming slang, syrup of fig, wig.
He can't even come to terms with being bald. Methinks he should remove the moat from his own eye and the syrup from his head before passing judgment on others.
One programme you all seemed to enjoy was Waiting for God, the seven-part comedy series starring Graham Crowden and Stephanie Cole.
I've never seen two actors scale so dangerously near to the top without actually going over.
Right, G.V. Thompson.
What a wonderful programme. About time we had a really good laugh.
Agrees Aileen Ross from Cambridge.
The Porsche scenes were great.
Damn it, woman! Watch out for the old folk!
We are the old folk.
Why are you driving on the wrong side of the road?
Because you never know when you're going to meet some silly sod doing it the other way.
Meanwhile, back to Michael Burke.
Good evening.
But it's not his tie this time, is it, Gene Downing?
Why does he have to keep on giving his own personal views on items at the end of the news? For example, about Princess Anne's visit to a part of Russia. Remark, a very special tourist. Grin, grin. About Dame Margot Fontaine's benefit gala. Remark, I hope you enjoy it. Grin, grin. When a kitten was shown on screen. Remark, ah. Ah, grin, grin. Make him break this nasty habit. Nobody else does it.
No, they don't, do they, grin, grin. By the way, have you been following the captions all right? Good.
You didn't publish my recent letter, and I can only conclude that was because it wasn't written in the right format, so as you can see, I have tried to help your typesetters by grouping my lines in pairs, centering my text and splitting my sentences and clauses entirely randomly. Incidentally, have you considered the enormous potential to be gained from imaginative use of the hive? Fen? It gives you the ability to con. Fuse your viewers no end. Well, must. Dash. Goodbye.
Thanks for the tip, Michael O'Reilly. But my letter of the week comes from Kirsty Hill, aged 12 years, 11 months and 2 days.
I'm writing to you about mad cow's disease. My mum has been eating beef for thousands of years, and she hasn't gone mad. Well, she is a bit mad, but the beef didn't do it. Me and my brother did.
You don't work for the Ministry of Agriculture, do you, Kirsty? Finally, I've been swamped by letters about the new format for Come Dancing.
Why do we have to include disco dancing?
Asks a disgusted Jerry Stokes from Lytham St. Anne's.
Leave it to Top of the Pops where it belongs, not forced onto viewers who enjoy good music and dancing. I'm not against change, but surely we can do without this.
It should be renamed Physical Jerks.
Adds Mary Leavis from Plymouth.
The old-time dancing dresses. Did someone shoot the ostrich?
So for all you Come Dancing fans, here's a final look at Angela's black bits. And I'll leave you with the dancing ostriches. See you next week.
Over on BBC Two shortly, MASH, and the happily married BJ has a crisis when he finds himself attracted to beautiful war correspondent Aggie. You're watching BBC One, and in 5 minutes we join Michael Burke for the 9 o'clock news. There now follows a party political broadcast by the Conservative Party.
What would be the cost of Labour's proposals to ordinary voters throughout Britain? That's
the question which is worrying millions. Let's see what's on the other side.
No, leave it a minute.
In Labour's policy document, there are 81 items they pledge themselves to spend money on. Yet Labour politicians say they won't have to put up taxes. We asked some independent authorities for their views. A vast economic study of Labour's stated policy has recently been undertaken by Professor Patrick Minford of Liverpool University.
We've taken Labour's policy review and costed the proposals in it. We find that it comes to $30 billion a year. We've put this programme through our computer-based analysis of the economy and asked how they could finance it consistently with their claim that it would be what the country could afford. We find that if they borrow to finance this programme entirely, the effects are horrendously inflationary, and therefore they would be forced to raise taxes. And we find that a rise of 6p in the standard rate would enable them to carry out the programme.
Stone me. Sixpence extra. What do we pay now? 25 pence, isn't it?
Yes. Another sixpence is a quarter more. I'd call that a tax increase, wouldn't you?
I'd call it outrageous.
But couldn't Labour raise the extra money by taxing higher earners?
No, it just doesn't look like it. The problem is there just aren't enough high earners. The Labour Party is hoping to raise about £2 billion from the high earners. Now, that is not enough to finance the range of programmes that they have in mind. And in doing it, the big increases in tax rates at that level is going to damage incentives and therefore restrict the amount of tax that will be raised.
So the inference is that the raises will have to come from the basic earner, from ordinary taxpayers.
Well, something certainly has to give. Either the programmes have to be cut back and made less ambitious, or there has to be a spreading of the tax burden more generally.
Doesn't add up, does it?
No. Either they won't keep their promises, or we'll get taken to the cleaners.
Labour also plan to introduce a new tax on savings.
They're suggesting that they're going to put 9% extra tax on savings, which increases the rate by about a third. And it does seem a discouragement to people to save, and particularly people trying to save during their earning life for their old age. They're having paid tax on their earnings during their working time, then to pay a surcharge when they're hoping to supplement their pension. Does seem very hard to me.
Hard? It's daylight robbery.
Can the policies outlined by the Labour Party succeed in fighting inflation?
In the last two Labour governments, inflation has gone up in the first 2 years very sharply, and the average inflation rate in both of those governments was much higher than in the 10 years of Thatcher government. And the reason for that high inflation is a failure to keep the government's finances and the country's finances under proper control.
But this time, Labour are suggesting they'll have very strict credit controls, specifically designed to keep inflation down.
Well, credit controls are very unfair. Large companies can avoid them by borrowing in the international capital markets, borrowing overseas. But for the small man, the man in the street, they can be effective. And what they mean, what credit controls mean, is a mortgage queue.
So credit controls are not a good thing. They're very a very bad thing for the ordinary voter.
Strike a chord.
Yes. We had those long waits for mortgages when Labour was in, didn't we?
Apart from high inflation and low growth, Professor Minford, what does your study suggest about the overall effect of Labour's policies on the economy?
The overall effect of this will be to raise taxation substantially, because to pay for this programme against a stagnant economy with high inflation needs much higher taxation. And the bottom line is that this will seriously damage the economy, and it will cost all of us a great deal of money.
Surely people won't fall for all that Labour won't raise taxes rubbish again. We've heard it all before.
It's like he said, when all is said and done, Labour would cost you more.
A lot more.
Labour would cost you more.
A lot more.
That was a party political broadcast by the Conservative Party. It will be shown again on BBC Two at 10:30. And that follows this week's screenplay, Antonia and Jane, a definitive annual report. Imelda Staunton and Saskia Reeves star in this contemporary comedy as two adult friends who meet up annually for a reunion dinner. That's on BBC Two at 9:25. Here on One in Half an Hour, theatre director and writer Ronald Eyre follows the route of the Irish border, the frontier that separates the North from the Republic of Ireland. First, the 9 o'clock news with Michael Burke.
The government's postponed its reforms to help the sick and the elderly because it would make the poll tax too expensive. Mrs. Thatcher calls for a new child support agency and says parenthood is for life. Good evening. The Health Secretary, Kenneth Clark, has put off reforms in community care which would have improved the quality of life for thousands of old, disabled and mentally handicapped people. The plan is to transfer responsibility to local councils so that people can be cared for at home rather than in institutions. But instead of being introduced next April, it will now be phased in over 3 years. Mr. Clark blamed the councils for the delay. The poll tax was already too high in many areas, he said, and introducing community care now would place an unacceptable burden on local taxpayers. Labour said the decision was shameful.
Community care for the old and disabled was one of the government's few policies warmly supported by the opposition, the unions and the main charities concerned with care of the frail. Already delayed 2 years since the Griffiths report, it was meant to respond to the needs of the growing army of people over 85. But now it's been postponed again. Arriving for a fierce Commons confrontation, Kenneth Clark was prepared to blame local council bad management for the need to delay or phase the plan.
It has become overwhelmingly clear that many local authorities are not managing their services and their spending so that they deliver good quality services effectively within reasonable spending limits. In many cases, even members on the opposite side must have noticed, local authorities have imposed excessive levels of community charge on their residents.
Does the Secretary of State recognise that his statement today will be almost universally greeted with anger for its neglect? For his neglect of the most vulnerable people in our community and contempt for the broken promises it leaves behind. Contempt also for the cowardice with which he attempts to palm off the blame on local authorities.
Although £30 million is to be salvaged from the policy for the mentally ill coming out of hospital, opposition MPs complained of the chaos caused by this last-minute change of plan.
Irrespective of what you think of whether community care is a good, a bad, or an indifferent thing, it's a stupid way. It's a stupid way to govern a country because the people, whether the local authorities or whether the care professionals, have got no idea whether they are coming or whether they are going.
Community care had no strong supporters in the cabinet. Kenneth Clark, like Mrs. Thatcher, was never enthusiastic about giving local authorities more power and more money. When council said they'd add £15 to next year's poll tax to help pay for it, the cabinet dropped the plan, or at least delayed it until well after the next election. It'll be people like Eva Richardson who may now not get the help they would have received under the community care scheme. Neighbours worry she's neglecting herself. She's become a little confused and forgetful.
What's the matter out there?
Widowed with no family, she can't reach her upstairs bathroom and has only a commode downstairs and one coal fire. Now she has little hope of joining the 5,000 people taken into the community care scheme in Kent. Christine Sturmey, by contrast, has a home help visiting her twice every day, and she's just been moved into a new Kent sheltered flat with all the help she needs.
Mrs. Sturmey, what would you like on your sandwiches today?
Can I have some cheese?
In her flat, on every wall, there's an alarm. She has a telephone and a warden nearby. Kent would have taken in another 2,500 people like Mrs. Sturmey during the next 12 months, with promised community care money. Now there'll be no money after all, and so no extra places. Kent's the government's model council for community care, with day centres offering hairdressing, meals, entertainment and baths, and beds for short stays to give relatives a break from caring for the old and disabled. Although it's firmly conservative, Kent Council is angry at having to abandon all its plans.
I think the community care delays will mean that a lot of people who would have been able to stay in their own homes a bit longer and perhaps even the remaining days there will not be able to be supported in their own homes. Many of their carers will not receive the support that they would have received if we'd have made these changes.
It was the £1 billion a year spent by Social Security on paying for people in private residential homes that caused the government to opt for community care. Today's announcement means that sum will continue to rise. Many now think community care will never be resurrected. The losers will be those like Mrs. Richardson. She wants to stay at home, but lack of money for council services means she may not get the choice.
The Prime Minister says the government is setting up a new child support agency to find absent fathers and make them pay maintenance for their children. She gave details of the scheme in a speech to a group campaigning for more women in Parliament. She told her audience that even though marriages break down, parenthood is for life.
This was the occasion Mrs. Thatcher was determined to use to put the family high on the political agenda before the next election. But the main focus of her speech was single parents and how to help recover maintenance payments from absent partners. the proposed agency would take over from the courts in assessing most maintenance payments according to ability to pay, and it would have powers to trace absent parents and deduct money directly from them if necessary.
For even though marriages may break down, parenthood is for life. Legislation can't make irresponsible parents responsible, but it can and must ensure that absent parents pay maintenance for their children.
Zoe Casey is one of more than a million single parents in Britain, three quarters of whom have to rely on Social Security because they receive no financial support from their absent partners. She's received no maintenance for herself and her son for the last 5 years and hopes the new agency would stop mothers like her having to go to court to try and get money they're entitled to.
I would like them to offer me and people in my situation the chance to be seen through or escorted through the whole procedure of divorce and separation and retrieving maintenance. Also, I would see them as being particularly beneficial as a third party, because often in divorces the main problem is communication or lack of it.
Those campaigning for the rights of single mothers gave a cautious welcome to the plans.
We're delighted with the tone of Mrs. Thatcher's speech and with her commitment for a separate child support agency working through the tax office. It's the first time we've got a commitment to a new system entirely. There are, however, problems. We don't know how much lone mothers are going to be able to keep of their maintenance before they lose benefit pound for pound. And, of course, fathers may not earn enough to pay for the upkeep of their family.
But Labour said the government's record on childcare proved it wasn't genuinely committed to help.
We've seen a lack of childcare, which is one of the main things to help women go back to work. And we've seen the government cut down the rights of part-timers, who are mostly working mothers. And we've seen them cut down maternity pay and maternity leave.
It's the image of a secure and stable family which lies at the heart of traditional Conservative values. But Mrs. Thatcher's aware that to win votes, she needs to reconcile that ideal with the reality that in the United Kingdom, there are now more single-parent families than almost anywhere else in Europe.
For the first time since the Vietnam War, America has said it wants a political dialogue with the Vietnamese. The American Secretary of State, James Baker, says the United States wants to talk to Vietnam about the future of Cambodia. It'll also end its recognition of the Khmer Rouge, which dominates the rebel opposition in Cambodia. Khmer Rouge forces operating from neighboring Thailand have in recent months pushed up to the capital, Phnom Penh. Today, they said they'd launched a big offensive against the city of Battambang, Cambodia's second largest city.
1.5 million people perished in the killing fields of Cambodia. The Khmer Rouge's years in power in the 1970s were the most brutal anywhere. The American move is prompted by fears that the Khmer Rouge may once again take power. Mr. Baker's announcement marks a major shift in US policy, which until today aimed only to isolate Vietnam and the government it backs in Cambodia. Now the Khmer Rouge threat is greater.
A major policy goal of ours continues to be to prevent the return to power of the Khmer Rouge. And we hope and believe that this will help move us in that direction.
The political situation in Cambodia is as fluid as it's ever been. Hun Sen's government is split over how to deal with the opposition, which includes the non-communist Prince Sihanouk, a former head of state, and Son San, declared prime minister in exile. But the coalition's military power comes from the Khmer Rouge, headed by Khieu Samphan. But this man, Pol Pot, is still the commander-in-chief of the Khmer Rouge army and the real power in the movement. He was in charge when the Khmer Rouge took power in 1975, and under him, the movement remains as powerful as ever, a fact recognized by other opposition leaders.
The Khmer Rouge, they are there. The Vietnamese want to eliminate them. Since 11 years, they cannot eliminate them. Hun Sen cannot eliminate them. I told Hun Sen, the more you want to fight them and to prevent them to go to Phnom Penh, you open the door of Phnom Penh to them. They are now at 45 kilometers from Phnom Penh.
It may persuade them, stimulate them to struggle militarily even harder to try and control as much of Cambodia as possible before the next stage of negotiations, if there is to be one. In other words, the shift in American support, which may have an effect on the Chinese, makes the Khmer Rouge isolated, and from that position of isolation, they want to build a position of strength.
For For the US, the images of the evacuation of its embassy staff from Saigon in 1975 were an affront to national pride. By announcing talks with Vietnam, Mr. Baker has signalled that the US has finally put that episode behind it.
Powerful aftershocks have disrupted the search for survivors of Monday's earthquake in the Philippines. Nearly 600 people have been killed and thousands injured or trapped by falling rubble. Fires are still burning in the northern city of Baguio, one of the worst hit areas. Water and electricity supplies to the region have been cut off.
A day and a half later, and the full horror of the earthquake which struck the northern Philippines on Monday is becoming apparent. A school teacher took these pictures. She was filming her pupils when the shock came. Moments later, the children were too terrified even to stand up. But despite their distress, they were the lucky ones. Many others died when buildings collapsed on top of them. Today, the full extent of the damage became clear. In Baguio, a mountain resort to the north of the capital, Manila, the Hyatt Terraces Hotel and Casino was reduced to rubble. Rescue efforts were hampered there by aftershocks, one of which registered 6.3 on the Richter scale. There have been more than 200 shocks since Monday, adding to the damage in Baguio, much of which has been destroyed either by the shocks or the fires that followed. The rescue teams, aided by helpers flying in from Europe and America, are having to cope with a lack of medical supplies, fresh water and food, and a growing risk of disease. As hope runs out of finding more survivors, the rescuers are preparing to use heavy lifting equipment to prise open damaged buildings and recover the bodies inside. Now, the main priority is helping the survivors. Radio stations have been broadcasting appeals for blood and asking doctors to go to the damaged areas to help the victims.
Here, the Education Secretary, John McGregor, has been jeered by delegates at a local education authority conference. The protesters claim that the futures of 500,000 school children will be blighted by cuts brought about by poll tax capping. Yesterday, the House of Lords upheld the government's decision to force 19 Labour-run councils to hold down their poll tax demands.
For the second day running, schools in Barnsley were hit by a teachers' strike protesting against redundancies caused by poll tax capping. Barnsley's one of the 19 education authorities who saw their last chance of avoiding capping disappear with yesterday's unsuccessful appeal to the House of Lords. Today, those councils confronted the Education Secretary as he addressed a gathering of all education authorities in Bradford.
Now they've lost their final appeal, the capped councils must decide very quickly where to make the cuts. All the education authorities here say schools and colleges can't be immune, and they can't rule out teacher redundancies.
The conference was warned that the capped councils face a bleak future.
Those 19 local education authorities are responsible for the education of over 500,000 of our school children. Their future prospects are now seriously blighted as a result of capping.
Mr. McGregor countered announcing new rules requiring councils to cut spending on town hall bureaucracy. He said if less was spent on central educational administration, there'd be more for school budgets. His critics dismissed this as a smokescreen to hide what one called the pillaging of education caused by capping. Mr. McGregor's response was jeered and heckled by delegates.
It is only too easy all the time to demand more spending and not look at those who have to pay. On some sort of assumption that somehow the money is conjured out of the air. So it was important to have a formula, and that a formula, as the courts have shown, was applied fairly and properly.
Afterwards, Mr. McGregor was criticised for failing to stand up for education in cabinet discussions over poll tax capping. And some capped councils talked of pursuing their legal challenge to the European Court.
Phone bills will go up in September. For millions of homes, the increases will be as high as 9%. Business charges will rise by a much smaller amount. The average for all users will be just over 5%.
These are the biggest price rises since BT was privatised in 1984, and the most controversial. Sir Brian Carsberg, head of the telecoms watchdog Oftel, has still to approve the details, though the average comes within his guidelines. BT is deliberately rejigging its pricing structure. It thinks domestic consumers should pay more, so cheap rate calls will go up by 15% on average, and domestic rental charges by nearly 12%.
My concern is that the domestic subscriber is being asked to pay, and this is an average, about 10% per annum more for their services. And they have nowhere else to go. There is no competition as far as the residential subscriber is concerned at this moment.
In the business market, BT faces stiff competition from Mercury in long-distance and international calls, so they've reduced prices for them by as much as 26%.
Businesses are subsidising residential customers. They have done for years. This is not a new phenomenon. And we're trying to redress the balance a bit so that our prices more reflect the costs that are actually incurred.
BT's pre-tax profits last year were a record £2.7 billion, but it's determined to do yet more rebalancing in future to make domestic consumers pay what it sees as the real cost of the service.
The post office will start Sunday collections throughout Britain by the end of the month. The scheme was launched in some parts of the country 4 months ago. The announcement came as the post office reported annual profits of £116.4 million. That's down £54 million on last year. Daphne Parrish, the British nurse set free after 10 months in an Iraqi jail, has been reunited with her family and friends back in Britain. Mrs. Parrish told waiting reporters at Gatwick Airport that it was marvellous to be home. She was arrested with the journalist Fazad Bazoft and jailed for allegedly spying. But she was freed after an appeal from the Zambian president, Kenneth Kaunda, earlier this week. Mrs. Parrish said she now wants to find a job. Nelson Mandela is back in South Africa after a tour of 14 countries. He flew back to a noisy welcome from ANC supporters, but also to death threats from right-wing whites, determined to stall negotiations with the South African government.
Police surrounded Jan Smuts Airport to protect Nelson Mandela from the far right. He's going to arrive home with a bang, they warned. Hoax bomb threats did delay Mr. Mandela's plane 3 hours, but the ANC leader still revelled in his reception, home on his 72nd birthday.
Happy birthday, Jaira. Happy birthday to you.
I feel like a boy of 36. And the present I would like to have is votes for all.
And the ANC leader hinted real progress towards his goal could be expected soon.
I propose to see Mr. de Klerk as soon as possible. And I'll be making efforts almost immediately to contact him. Because we as the ANC are very keen to have the next meeting with the government.
And both sides now believe that next meeting could remove the remaining obstacles to full constitutional talks. Most important of all, an agreement on the release of political prisoners seems close, although the ANC is still worried about being seen by its supporters doing a deal which gets right-wing extremists out of jail too. The ANC would like the government to take full responsibility for the freeing of men like Barent Strydom, a fanatical supporter of apartheid who killed 7 black people shot at random on a crowded street in Pretoria. And violence in South Africa remains the greatest threat to future democracy. Today, at least 25 people were killed when a bus and a minibus turned over on a road near Durban after shots were fired at one of the drivers. Attackers and victims were all black, caught up in Natal's faction fighting, much of it between rival gangsters, but much else the result of a political struggle between supporters of Chief Buthelezi and Nelson Mandela. James Robbins, BBC News, Johannesburg.
The Labour leader, Neil Kinnock, has been having talks with leading members of the American Senate on the last day of his visit to the United States. One of his meetings was with Senator Joseph Biden, who was forced out of his bid for the presidency because he copied Mr. Kinnock's speeches.
Neil Kinnock's schedule has been a who's who of Washington politics, from the President, Vice President, National Security Advisor and Defense Secretary to Capitol Hill and congressional leaders. Tom Foley is the Speaker of the House of Representatives, constitutionally the third most important politician in America. Mr. Foley's Democrats traditionally have been close to Britain's Labour Party. But not so the more conservative Republicans, yet Mr. Kinnock received a warm welcome even here from senior senators like Bob Dole and Richard Lugar, listening to his views on aid to Mikhail Gorbachev.
We had a very enjoyable meeting. He certainly is a good friend of the United States. Likewise, we've enjoyed seeing him before. He simply pointed out that we're strong allies in NATO. That is likely to continue for a long time.
What has been impressive to many of us is the steady and continuing leadership that Mr. Kinnock has provided in a wide variety of different issues, both domestically and in foreign policy.
Then a lunch hosted by Senator Joe Biden, a man who shares many Kinnock concerns. In fact, Biden's 1988 presidential campaign fell apart after he plagiarized a Kinnock speech. Imitation, the dangerous form of flattery.
If and when he becomes prime minister, I hope he still is willing to recognize who I am and call me Joe, and occasionally use some of my material.
I'm glad he'd do that.
On his last visit here 3 years ago, Neil Kinnock was an outsider beating on Washington behind closed doors. Now he's an insider and, in the view of many people here, quite possibly on the way up. Gavin Esler, BBC News, Washington.
Labour's National Executive Committee is planning a new crackdown on militant infiltration in Liverpool. The BBC has learned tonight that the city's district party will be suspended and 14 more councillors are to be disciplined. 15 others who defied the National Party leadership have already been removed from the Labour group on the City Council.
For some years now, Labour's control over Liverpool's political life has been marked by allegations of gross inefficiency, corruption and infiltration by the extremist militant tendency. 5 years ago, Neil Kinnock's patience snapped when he rounded on militant and ordered a purge. Now, with the city's finances in chaos, Liverpool's new Labour Party is once again being torn apart by internal conflict. Left-wing councillors have defied the law by refusing to vote for setting a local poll tax and endorsing council rent rises to help balance the city's books. Now, the party's ruling national executive, which meets next week, is expected to endorse a clampdown on three fronts. 14 rebel councillors are to be disciplined, in effect ousted from the Labour group. The District Labour Party, which brings together councillors and local activists, is to be suspended, and so too is the local Women's Committee. Across the Mersey in Birkenhead, a second clampdown. 8 Labour Party members named in an inquiry following the deselection of Frank Field are to be suspended, preventing them from holding office pending a longer-term investigation. That removes them from the local selection committee and leaves the way clear for an early rerun of Mr. Field's reselection. His rival, Paul Davis, who's been cleared of any militant connections, will then have a second chance of being nominated to fight Birkenhead for Labour at the next election. Neil Kinnock wrestles with a dilemma. He's gained public support in the past by moving against the extremists, certainly those defying the law. And yet he must know that a new clampdown is bound to attract unwelcome attention from the Conservatives. Clearly, though, he's decided that by acting now, he will deprive his opponents of the chance of exploiting this issue nearer the general election.
The government has been defeated in the House of Lords tonight over a clause in the broadcasting bill. The Lords voted by 91 votes to 64 in favour of an amendment aimed at reinforcing public service broadcasting. The vote would mean that ITV companies will be required to devote a certain amount of time to documentaries, educational and other special interest programmes. The European Commission President Jacques Delors has arrived in Moscow to discuss ways in which Europe can help the ailing Soviet economy. He'll be meeting President Gorbachev for talks on possible financial aid and better trade links.
Jacques Delors arrived in Moscow this afternoon, his mission to find out from the Soviet government itself the extent of the economic mess that it's in, and to decide whether European aid would assist change or simply prop up the old failed system. Mr. Delors will meet economists and government officials, and tomorrow President Gorbachev himself. If Gorbachev is honest, he'll tell the Commission President that the Soviet Union faces economic collapse, lengthening queues, the outward sign of the disintegration of the command economy. These people are queuing for nothing more desirable than soap powder. The Soviet government wants to placate its angry shoppers with Western goods. But Western businessmen already here are cautious. Pizza Hut are opening in Moscow soon. Their British manager says if the EC money comes, it must have strings attached.
I think the main thing that is required is help in spending that money in a way that will give the best results for the people. And that really boils down to a lot of good management.
Leonid Abalkin, one of Mr. Gorbachev's principal economic advisers, would agree wholeheartedly with that. He met Mr. Delors this afternoon to tell him about his increasingly desperate attempts to set up a market economy here, attempts which are meeting serious opposition. The message from the Soviet government to Mr. Delors is simple. If you want perestroika to succeed, you must help now. Because if the necessary economic reforms are to be put in place, we need the breathing space that your money can provide. Justin Webb, BBC News, Moscow.
Cricket in England have been well beaten by India in the first Texaco Trophy International at Headingley. The Indians bowled them out for 229 and won by 6 wickets with 2 overs to spare.
On a perfect day for batting, India's bowlers, written off as inadequate, chose the ideal moment to exploit cricket's capacity for confounding critics. From the moment Atherton got a shooter from Prabhakar, England were involved in an unexpected struggle. For a while, Gower, recalled yet again, revived some favourite memories. But the introduction of spin got England in a tangle. Gooch caught and bowled for 45, and on his departure, the run rate dropped significantly as Kumbley first baffled, then confounded Gower, who just reached 50. Belatedly, Alan Lamb went on the offensive as 18 came off 1 over. But when he went, spooning a catch to long off, he took with him England's hopes of a commanding score, and the critics' words were being put to a more useful purpose. A total of 229 never looked like being enough, as the elegant Mandrekar was to emphasise after the early loss of Rahman. At 76, he did lose the effective support of Sidhu, suffering just as Atherton had. But Mandrekar was never really troubled by an England attack lacking in both variety and penetration. After he'd gone for 82, India duly completed a victory so comprehensive it's offered the prospect of a fascinating test series ahead.
Tonight's main news again. The government has postponed its community care reforms because it would make the poll tax too expensive. More on Newsnight on BBC Two at 10:35, but that's the 9 o'clock news tonight. Good night.
From Newsroom South East, the main stories this evening. The government's chief inspector of prisons has condemned a young offender's jail in Oxfordshire as a positive aid to suicide. A report into Campfield House prison near Oxford has described it as depressing and outdated. Now, the Home Office plans to close it down next April after Judge Stephen Tumim, the author of the report, said such institutions should be used as little as possible for teenagers under 16. Demonstrators picketed Woodstock Town Hall today as Oxfordshire's first summonses for poll tax evasion were being heard. 90 people have been prosecuted so far for non-payment. The building was daubed with graffiti and locks were filled with superglue. Company director David Fell has been jailed for 6 months by the Old Bailey for reckless driving. He caused the death of 11-year-old Helen Morris on her bicycle on the pavement near her home in Kingston-upon-Thames. Fell tried a racing driver manoeuvre in his sports car, which went wrong. A woman has been seriously injured this evening in an accident involving a glider at Kenley Aerodrome near Croydon. The glider plummeted 300 feet after being released too early. Police in Berkshire have issued a photo fit of a man who attacked a nurse at knife point in a hospital car park in Reading. He's about 5'6" tall, aged between 25 and 35. The attack happened as the nurse was parking her car at Prospect Park Hospital on Thursday, but details only emerged today because the victim was so distressed. 7,000 London office workers took part in a fun run in the sweltering heat in Battersea Park today as part of a fitness at work campaign. But it had its serious side, with international runner Eamon Martin coming in first to complete the 3.5-mile course in just under 16 minutes. He goes on to compete in a world final in New York in November. And that's all.
Good evening to you. It must have felt like home from home for the Indian cricketers today. The warmest place, or hottest place, should I say, was in fact Leeds, with a temperature of 30 degrees Celsius, 86 Fahrenheit. Few other hot spots around the country, but despite 15 hours of sunshine, some of these coastal areas were much cooler. The temperatures there are refreshing 21 to 23. Well, here's a global satellite picture. Clear blue skies from the thunderstorms over the equator right up to the British Isles. You can just pick out this nice little V-shape. There's a closer look at it. Clear blue skies for the country today, but thicker cloud across the north and northwest brought one or two showers to western Scotland and western Ireland. Well, we're set with high pressure to rule the roost, though. These fronts to the west will give some heavy bursts of rain in western Scotland tonight. Then, as it comes across the country, a much more weakening feature and then disappearing altogether during the weekend. So high pressure ruling the roost. We will pick up an easterly breeze in southern parts of Britain, so that may help things as far as pollen goes and the low-level pollutants. They will mostly move northwards towards Northern Ireland and Scotland. Overnight then, rain pushing into parts of Northern Ireland and western Scotland. A good deal of mist and fog too, but over England and Wales, a clear night, one or two mist patches. The temperatures here around 13 to 15, but in the north they'll fall as low as 11. Well, tomorrow over much of England and Wales, very little change, unbroken sunshine. Fairly cloudy start for much of Northern Ireland and western and northern Scotland. Still some rain around, some mist and fog patches as well. But things improving during the day, the rain becoming much more showery over Northern Ireland and Scotland. Perhaps one or two showers for the open Gulf as it starts tomorrow, but it could start off fairly misty, then improve, and then perhaps a shower. But the top temperatures will be around about 22 degrees Celsius on this eastern coast of Scotland, but for the south, again, a very hot day. The temperatures in London likely to be as high as 29 degrees Celsius. And then for the weekend, continuing fine and sunny over much of the country, and quite warm too, the temperatures in the south as high as 28.
This Friday at 10:20, a feature-length drama depicts the troubled genius of Vincent van Gogh.
You are not wanted here, Vincent. You are not wanted here! I will never leave. And I draw, 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 and I draw. And I no longer feel helpless before nature.
I wish I was an egg.
Yes.
Perfect within my shell.
An impressionistic look at the life of Vincent van Gogh. Omnibus, Friday at 10:20 on BBC One.
In 50 minutes, Dennis Quaid stars in our political science fiction thriller Dreamscape. A scientific experiment on dream linking, by which psychics can enter the dreams of others, turns into a nightmare for guinea pig Alex Gardner when he discovers he's being used in a plot against the President of the United States of America. First, we follow the Irish border from Lough Foyle in the north to Carlingford Lough in the south, in Frontiers.
Here I am, starting a film by opening a map. I know perfectly well where the start of the Irish border is, but I'm...